do want to talk about your film, which really is based on your life to at least some extent. Mm-hmm. Some of us have seen the film, some of you haven't. It's called Acts of Worship. For the students who haven't seen it, can you just talk about it a little bit?
Sure. The movie is born out of a need, many needs. One is to finally be a director, but that's sort of the least of it. The most driving force of the movie was I finally had something, I think, to say that was very personal, that was necessary for me to say in order to get to whatever the next level of life is, you know? So I say that because I think that's the most important thing, is that people, there's too many bad movies out there, and people making movies for the wrong reason. And I really believe that everybody has a story, but you have to, again, like try to find your voice. Nestor does stand-up comedy. He was doing like a whole joke thing about finding your voice last night, so I just got sidetracked in my mind. Because it was cracking me up. To find your voice and to really have something to say. So, you know, I sort of went through those jobs, and really the last job that I had was Salon Bombay. And then I knew, because like I told you guys, like I like to have fun a lot, so that sort of took over my goals and my dreams, was the idea of just going out and just drinking way too much, having too much fun here, too many drugs, and sort of taking a detour. And at that point, the one thing I think that I'm grateful for is that I sort of stopped working at film, because that, at that job in particular, I was running downtown trying to get jobs, coming back up in the cat. Like, I was happy they put me on the night shift, so I was editing at night, and no one was around, but I don't want to mess up that part of my life. So obviously it was something that was very important to me, because I messed up every other part of my life, you know what I mean? And I came close to messing up that part, but I sort of took a detour, and then, you know, my life just went kind of down the toilet for a while, and then, having got to the other side of that, it was like I kind of knew when I got another chance, which many people don't, that I did have something to say, and that film was my medium, that was my passion, and that I needed to do that. It wasn't until after I made the movie that I realized I needed to do that to let go of something in my past, like just to sort of let go and move forward, like I said. So I think that's what the movie was born on, that need. Which I really think that people, in general, filmmakers need to go inside. Producers don't. They just need to support us in our journey to like, because why do we make movies? And I don't think enough people really ask that question, and they get caught up in the glamour of everything. You know, it's not. I mean, you talk about producers over the weekend working. It's not glamorous. It's only the fantasy of it is glamorous. The actual reality of it is very hard, very hard work, and the reason we do it is to, well, the reason I do it is to try to connect with another human being, and that's what, you know, because it's that's my medium.
And the character in your movie is a young woman who's really spiraling downward because of drugs. How much does that reflect your life? And is there a lesson in there to be learned? I mean, that young woman was saved. How were you saved? It sounds so religious, but I don't mean it.
Well, yeah. Well, I mean, it's called Acts of Worship, but it's definitely not religious, although there's religious icon in there and various things, because that means a lot of different things to different people. Ana Rita plays Alex, and she does an extraordinary job. She's in Top Girls right now, so if any of you have a chance on Broadway, if you haven't had a chance to go see it, it's a great play. She's great in it. Martha Clinton's great. It's a great female cast. But anyway, she did a great job of sort of diving into this character that is at her bottom. And there's only a montage in the beginning that sort of reflects any kind of normalcy that she may have left behind. Because the point of the movie is there's a variety of characters that are at bottoms in their life. And it doesn't matter who you are, where you come from, this can happen. It can happen. It's addiction. We all know addicts, we all know alcoholics who mess up their lives to varying degrees. And I'm actually, in retrospect, one of the fortunate ones because I dove into it so hard that I actually just, instead of spanning over like 20 or 30 years and ruining my life and everyone around me and my family, like I actually got to like go intensely into it for like a few years and then get out and then get on with my life. So, and yeah, so I was that character. Basically, there's things in my own life that I wouldn't put in a movie. That was personal enough. I did not have the character. Digna is all fictionalized because I think when you deal with real life, you sort of have to. I really believe in structure and telling a good story. So, you know, I have to sort of fictionalize. It's not an autobiography for that reason. But yeah, that character really wasn't in my life. It was more of just ending up in the emergency room, actually on set at Greeny Medical Center right down the street, ending up there and just realizing I was going to die and just having some kind of crap in my thick head where I was like, oh my God, what do I do now? You know? So, and then people came in to help me. But you know, that was the point, sort of, where she ends up asking for help. Mm-hmm. That is real. So there's points in it. But certainly the first, say, 15 minutes of the movie are very realistic to things I experienced.
And you would have to know that world.
Yeah.
I mean, I found it really unnerving when I was watching it. And it really scared me. And it did make me feel like absolutely that this could happen to anybody, that it could even happen to me. And I don't even consider myself to be a particularly addictive personality. But I think that's what's so unnerving about that. So, I mean, that's what you wanted to accomplish.
I think that's good because I think that, you know, the reason it's called acts of worship is because there are various things that people rely on. It may not be crack and heroin. It might be food. It might be gambling. It might be sex. It could be just another person that you just are obsessed with and can't live without. I mean, so it is good to sort of wake up and say, wow, you know, to connect with that rather than separate yourself from that. Because that is my intention, was to not to eliminate judgment, but also to connect you to some degree of that experience with addiction and vision. And that's a good thing.
What year was that you went to Sundance?
2001.
And what was that experience for you? Sundance has changed a lot since 2001. I don't know if you've gone back, but what was it like in 2001?
Yeah, I went this year actually, it was different, but it was sort of in its second year of being very celebrity driven. Even at that point, it sort of had already taken off with the focus being a little different. And it was already in 2001 a launching pad for studio movies, and bigger independent. Like Lionsgate stuff. So it was already, the slots were filled with, you know, those type of films. So it was already there. But we had, Nestor came as a producer, of course, and we had a great time. Sundance is an amazing place. The people that run that festival, although they may be criticized, I think their heart's in the right place. I think that they treated us as well as they treated anyone there, I mean, which is very good. I mean, they love their filmmakers. And so we had a great time. But I was exceedingly naive because I thought, and I'm not sure if necessarily, but I thought that if you just make a good enough movie, then it'll take care of itself. So I actually envisioned it being at, you know, over here, like when we're on Broadway, down there. Broadway and like 13th Street, that's where I saw my movie.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I sort of went to Sundance thinking that was going to happen, which I'm sure everybody does on some level. But I didn't have anything in place to even think about that happening. And I don't, number one, having named actors on a movie, it's not a genre movie, so that right there would make it really next to impossible, even at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just gotten worse. And then, you know, you have to have your publicist, you know, the right publicist in place, you have to have the right sales rep, producer's rep in place, sales agent, blah, blah, blah. You we just showed up and had a